Welcome everyone to the Red Hat Society Lifestyle Speaker Series. I am so excited for today's speaker, but first a few Zoom housekeeping tips and tricks about today's event. So we want to make this as interactive as humanly possible. So you'll notice at the bottom of your Zoom window, there are two different ways that you can participate in today's show. There's the chat feature. So go ahead and just open up that chat. Tell us where you're coming from. One of the greatest things about the Red Hat Society, it is truly a global organization. So pop open that chat, let us know where you're coming from. And then also another way that you can get involved is asking questions. We've got a Q&A box. Oh, we've got some Abilene, Texas, and some California people coming in here, and from some Michigan, Southern California, some amazing places here. But another way you can get involved is with the Q&A box. So go ahead and submit your questions for our speaker. We're going to try to make this, again, as interactive as possible and get all of the questions that you all want to get answered a little bit later on throughout the course of today's show. There is also going to be a raffle today. So the more you participate and the more you ask your questions and get your questions in there, you're going to be entered into a raffle for a prize valued at $500. It's going to be a complete style makeover, virtual makeover with our host here today. So speaking about our host, once again, so get those questions in so you can get some of those entries into the contest. But speaking of our host, he is the reason why we are all here, and he currently travels the world virtually helping men and women create their own signature style. He's a red carpet stylist, a celebrity makeup artist, international runway model, author, and creator of Billy's Blues Cosmetic. Please welcome Mr. William Squire.
Good morning. Hi, Daniel. How are you?
I'm doing fantastic. How are you, William?
I'm great. Well, thank you for being here. We never introduced you, Daniel Slotkey, who has been my producer for many years, and we work together so well. But thank you for being here because you make everything run so smoothly, and I appreciate it because I couldn't do it without you.
No problem at all. I am so happy to be here. But once again, make sure you get those questions in to enter into the raffle, and then also go to billysblues.com to sign up for the newsletter, which, William, you've got a lot of good stuff that happens in your newsletter, right?
I do. Thank you for reminding me. I will try to make sure everybody knows about that a little bit later on. Anyway, that was just I think that place is falling apart, by the way. Don't worry about those noises. Thank you, Daniel, so much for being here with me. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, ladies, wherever you are today. I appreciate you being here with me. I am so thrilled. I can't tell you. I have been looking forward to this for such a long time. In fact, I was hoping to meet you all in person at some point, but we've kind of had to put that on hold. But I do want to thank all of you for taking time out of your busy day to be here with me. I'd love to thank Deborah Granich, of course. Thank you for finding me. Thank you for this long relationship we've had trying to get together and creating some fun events, and I appreciate it. And Joe Elliott, thank you for making it so easy. You made my job easy by doing all of the hard work. So I really do admire all of you in the Red Hat Society, the Red Hatters, the Pink Hatters. I think it's a wonderful organization. And again, I thank you for spending time with me today. I hope that you'll learn some things. I hope that you'll get some ideas. This is a perfect time as we all enter winter, and many of us are homebound, and because of obviously the pandemic, I think many of us are staying home more than often anyway. So a perfect time to maybe rethink our look, rethink a little bit about how we want to emerge this spring with something new and exciting. So I hope you'll all just sit back, relax. If you have questions, I'm here for you. I want you to consider me your own personal stylist for the next 45 minutes. So what do I do? What is the job of a Hollywood stylist? Well, you know, my main job is to make my clients look good and feel good. That's probably the most important thing that I do with them. But also there's some other things that are involved. I have some photos I want to show you. Here I am shopping in Beverly Hills with a client. This is what I do oftentimes too. And we're trying to find an outfit or cosmetics or anything for a certain event. Oftentimes we'll go shopping in the stores in Beverly Hills. It's crazy though, because the paparazzi is all around us and it makes it very difficult. So oftentimes we'll do it when the stores are closed. Here I am getting a group of people ready for the Academy Awards, I believe the Oscars. And let me tell you, my style team, I have a style team of anywhere of 8 to 20 people, because oftentimes, in fact, for the last Emmys, I think we got 55 clients ready. So oftentimes it's not just one or two people. We get large groups of people ready for the award shows. Here I'm working at the Grammys, and you can see I'm working very closely with my stylist, making sure that the nominee or the guest has exactly what they want. It's my job to create not only the hair, the makeup, the clothing, but the entire look. Oftentimes too, here I am holding the hand of a nominee. I won't tell you who it is, but this was at the Emmys back before a few years ago anyway, before we kind of stopped that. And sometimes it's my job to actually make them calm, to make them feel good about it. I'm telling her, don't worry whether you win or lose. It's all great because you look gorgeous. So anyway, I have many, many hats that I wear. And of course, on the red carpet itself, styling, making sure that my ladies and gentlemen look great before they get onto the camera. Now, let me tell you, I've got to just share a story. Do you mind? I'm going to just throw some stories in here. I hope you don't mind. I was at the Golden Globes, and it was funny because, you know, people don't know who I am. I'm kind of in the background, but I was out at the party after I got all my clients ready, and a group of women, about a dozen women, said, can we have our photo taken with you? And I just thought, oh my gosh, how wonderful. This doesn't happen often, you know, so my head was huge, and I thought, yay, I'm going to do it. Well, I'm standing there with all these women behind me, and I hear all the ladies screaming. I went, wow, I guess I really am famous. So guess what happened? Guess who arrived right when that happened? George and Amal Clooney were on the red carpet. They just arrived. So this was the photo that you just saw, and you'll see again. This was the photo I got. I had no idea what had happened, but I got this photo. And all of them had turned away, looked at George and Amal, and that was the photo I was left with. So it's kind of fun, and I keep it, in my presentation because I never want my head to get too big. Anyway, all right. So what I'd like to share with you is I have five of the most important and biggest trends in makeup. And when I talk about trends, I've been doing these tricks for 30 years now, but I think they're popular now. A lot of the artists are doing them, and I think that you're seeing them. And I think in order to really feel beautiful, look beautiful, you might want to consider some of these and see if you might want to update your makeup just a little bit. So let's talk about red carpet trend number one. All righty, ladies, we are elongating the eyeliner and we're using blue mascara. And what do I mean by that is we start on the very corner of the eye, go all the way out to the very end of the eye. Here's another example of a client of mine, Vanessa. You can see how we take the eyeliner all the way from the tip corner all the way out with a little bit of a flip at the very end. I love to show before and after pictures just because you can tell I get excited about makeup. But when I was in Paris and I got to Vanessa's flat, this was Vanessa without makeup. And she's a beautiful woman, but you can see why and how excited I get. Then we did this for a Chanel campaign. And after I got the makeup on, I just get so excited and happy about it because the transformations are so much fun. So anyway, a beautiful woman with it, but a beautiful woman without as well. But anyway, I love what makeup can do. So anyway, when you're doing your eyeliners, lady, try not to do too much. What happens if we enclose the entire eye? It makes the eye smaller. You enclose any object, it's going to make it quite small. This next photo really shows what I'm talking about. Look at this. I love this picture. Exactly the same hair, same makeup. It wasn't Photoshop. It was just by encircling one eye with liner all the way around, and the other eye, just putting it along the top, which is where I recommend putting your eyeliner, just along the top, not along the bottom. But can you believe the difference? So for those of you that have been lining your eyes all the way around or on the inside of the waterline, try this look. I think you'll be amazed at what actually happens. So here's just really the perfect look. Eyeliner, just very softly all the way along the top, a little bit of a scoop out at the end. And underneath, if you want to do a little bit of shadow, a little mascara, you can, but try not to line the entire eye underneath. Ladies, I want to talk to you for a moment about eyebrows. Eyebrows we're doing this season too. We're making them full. We're making them, again, longer, and we're creating that perfect shape. You'll see here an example of before and after eyebrows of, and this isn't one of my clients. This is just something I found online, but I just thought it was such a perfect example of what happens when you do have a full eyebrow compared to an eyebrow that's not filled in. And then here's also another example of the eyebrows. And you can see what a difference. This is Margot Robbie, who's so beautiful either way, but we really are doing a little bit fuller of an eyebrow this season. Let me show you what I mean. I'm going to show you actually when you're putting on your eyebrow. Daniel, I'm going to bring it back to me here for a minute. You're so good. Anyway, ladies, when you're working with your eyebrow pencil, the one thing you want to remember too is when you're putting it on, don't just draw it on in long strokes. You want to actually take small little strokes going up as you're filling in the eyebrow with the hair. You're making it look like hair all the way up, and then you can extend it a little bit further. Also remember, ladies, when you're putting your eyebrow on, you want to start the eyebrow right where your eye starts. So you go to the corner of the eye, you go up, and that's where you want to start your eyebrow. You don't want it to be too far over, too far to the other side. You really want it to go in a line with the eye all the way up. And then go ahead and you just want to brush up the hair and make it very natural. But do spend those extra few moments with the eyebrow. I think you'll really find it makes a huge difference. All right, blue mascara. How many of you, when I say blue mascara, it takes you back to the 1980s, and you're thinking, blue mascara? Oh my gosh, I wore bright electric blue mascara when I went to a Madonna concert, right? Well, blue mascara is not that anymore. I've used blue mascara for my clients for the 35 years I've been doing makeup. And what I do is a deep navy blue. And look what it does. And why do I use navy blue mascara? If any of you are designers, I know that you're wanting to scream out the answer. What it does is it makes the eyes look wider. If you have a white couch and you put on a blue pillow next to that white, guess what? All around that blue pillow, you're going to see it looking much wider. So by putting a navy mascara along with the lashes, look how much wider the eyes will look. And this is a navy mascara. You can coat it. You can just tip the lashes. You can put it over brown. You can put it over black. But do not be afraid of blue mascara. I guarantee you is one of the number one trends, and you will thank me. Daniel, I see you. What's going
on? I've got a very topical question. Usually we say the questions for the end, but this one was so topical.
Sure.
We had somebody, Carolyn asked, what do you do with no eyebrows? How do you work that in to the makeup process?
Oh, you know what, then that's a great question, Carolyn. You know, and that is an issue. Oftentimes women have shaved their eyebrows, or of course from different treatments, you may lose your eyebrows. What you've really got to do again is just get a great pencil and just draw it on. What you want to do after you draw it on, and that's one thing that will make a difference. If you draw it on and you do small little strokes, it'll look very realistic. The other thing you can do is after you draw it on, get a little bit of powder. And by putting a little bit of powder there, it makes it not look so much if it's being drawn on. And I also use a waterproof pencil. My pencil in my line is waterproof. Some women use powder. I just happen to like a waterproof pencil because I think it stays on. And you know, it's just going to take you practicing getting that brow, putting a little bit of powder. And then even if you want, going over it again, and don't get it looking too perfect. Have it look like little tiny hairs, and nobody will notice. It's one of those things you'll notice, but nobody else will actually notice. Ladies, I just wanted to show you. Thank you, Daniel. This is my cosmetics company, by the way, called Billy's Blues. We will talk about it later. And I have a very special gift and a very special promotion for all of you ladies that are with me today. But as I say, blue is the new black. So if you've not tried navy mascara, give it a try. I think you'll like it. All righty, let's go move on to red carpet trend number two. This is, ladies, are you ready? False eyelashes. How many of you remember wearing false eyelashes? Those of you that maybe were around in the 1960s, wearing those false eyelashes. Well, you know, they are back with a vengeance, and they're so beautiful. This is my model, Broadway star Sandra Allen, wearing these lashes, and nobody would necessarily look and think they're false. And even if they do, don't they look great? Marilyn Monroe used to wear false eyelashes. Obviously, we knew that back from the 1950s. Even today, celebrities on the red carpet, you're seeing Angelina Jolie always wears her false eyelashes, Rihanna. I mean, it's just something that you're seeing a lot of today, and especially on the red carpet. This happens to be just this photo was taken of the beautiful 83-year-old Jane Fonda last month. And in fact, I have a quote. I just have to read you really quick here. And of course, her makeup artist, David, always uses false eyelashes on Jane. And I just want to share one. Jane says, we're still living with the old paradigm of age as an arc. But that's an old metaphor. You're born, you peak at midlife and decline into decrepitude. A more appropriate metaphor for aging is a staircase, the upward ascension of the human spirit, bringing us into wisdom, wholeness, and authenticity. I love that about her. She embraces every age, every moment. But again, look at those great lashes. So ladies, do not be afraid of lashes. In fact, you want me to show you the number one question I get with lashes when I tell women about lashes is they say, but they're so hard to put on. And I understand it can take a moment. Do you know what's fun, actually? A friend of mine ordered lashes for their whole group. They got together, a group of women, and they had an eyelash party, and they all put them on. They had a great time. I'm sure they had quite a bit of wine, but they had so much fun. So anyway, eyelash glue. I use a glue that's just kind of a white clear color. I don't like it to be white. It's actually clear. If you use white, use black, you can kind of see it. But I'm just going to show you really quickly, if you don't mind. I'm going to get you right here so you kind of see what I'm doing. Here's one of my lashes. They're called Wonder Lashes from the 1960s. You take a little bit of that glue and you just go right along the lash line, right there along the top. You put it on, you let it dry for just a moment. And then when you're putting them on your lashes, this is where a lot of women, I think, get confused. You can put them on and then you can pull them off. You can put them on, you can pull them off. These last forever. These are not lashes you throw away. And once you get enough glue on there, actually, they kind of just stay on even without applying glue. So what you want to do, you want to look straight into your mirror. You want to just drop the lashes right where you think they need to go. Push one corner down, put the other corner down, and you kind of got them on there. But then if you need to move them around a little bit, you can move that side down, you can move them over, but they're so much fun. And once you get used to using them, they'll make such a difference. So if you haven't used lashes, false eyelashes in a while, go back to use them, ladies. I think you're going to really love them. All righty, ladies, red carpet trend number 3, blush. Oh, thank you, Daniel. That was a picture of with and without lashes. And isn't that fun? I just think the look is beautiful. I don't think they look too heavy. I don't think they look like they're overdone or, you know, back in the 90s, I would say, oh, look kind of like drag queen, right? Or it looked too heavy. But look at them now. They're so beautiful. So thank you. I love that, the difference of lashes. Ladies, red carpet trend number 3, blush. It's all about your blush. And what I mean about blush is it goes all over the entire face. Remember, any of you remember going to the makeup chair in the early 80s? You'd sit down and they'd say, smile, and let's paint the apple of your cheeks. Well, we're not doing that anymore, thank goodness. What we're doing is we're doing all around the entire face. We're doing it around the cheeks. We're doing it on the temples, on the hairline, on the chin, and don't forget the neck area. So when you're actually doing your blush, what you want to do is get your powder brush, your blush brush. You want to grab your blush and do a color that really is a natural color. You don't want it to look too coral, too orange, too red. You want it to be something very soft, and go all the way around the cheek, go on the hairline, go on the sides of the nose, go up into the hairline. You want it to look like you just came in from a good workout. You never want someone to run up and say, boy, I love your blush. You want them to come up and say, you look so healthy. You've got this beautiful color to your skin. So anyway, the difference of your blush too is putting correctly really makes a difference. Remember to keep it high on the cheeks and soft enough that you see it, but it's not too harsh. I have a story to tell you. I think, oh, this next photo is showing what happens if it's a little bit, oh, and the neck. Thank you, Daniel. Do not forget the neck area, ladies. You can see the difference if your blush is too strong or too low. It really brings down the face. Once we're over the age of 35, everything gets pushed up, right? So your blush is high up on the cheek, not down in the hollow of the skin. I was doing the Emmys one year with Jamie Lee Curtis, and it's funny because she, you know, she's all over the place. She's running around, and I said, Jamie, we got to get your makeup done. Okay, I'll be there in a minute, you know. So finally she came over. We had about 20 minutes to do her makeup. Ladies, when you're doing your makeup, I always start with your foundation, and then I start with the lips. I know a lot of women start with the eye, putting the eyeshadows on. I can't do it that way. I've been doing makeup 35 years. I guess I'm just not talented enough, because for me, it's so much easier to do your lips and then your blush. See how I did Jamie's blush? It's all around the face. The lips are on. And then I did her eyebrows. Now, if she needed to go out onto the stage with just lips, blush, and eyebrows, she would have looked great. But if I had started with the eyes, I might not have had time to complete the rest of the look. So next time you do your makeup, think lips first, blush color, eyebrows, and then with the eyeshadow, I just throw 2 colors on. We used to do, what, 5 colors, if you all remember. But now what we do is I just do a light color all over the eye and very soft, just a little bit of a smudge of a darker color in the corner, a liner, a little navy mascara, boom, out the door. And I think she looks beautiful. And that was about a 15-minute makeover. So you don't need to take a ton of time. I know we're all busy. All right, ladies, let's talk about red carpet trend number 4. It is about lip liner, it is about lipstick, and it's about gloss. So ladies, how many of you use a lip liner? I'm looking, I'm pretending we're all live and I can see you raising your hand. Some of you, most of you may be raising your hand, but do get in the habit of using a lip liner if you don't. I don't know anyone that has perfect lips. It's funny, a lot of the celebrities that we think have these beautiful lips, they're drawn on with a lip liner. So you can create whatever lip you want. Here's an example of just, you know, an average pair of lips. We take the lip liner, we fill the lip in a little bit, we give it a little bit of fullness, and then you apply your lipstick. But really, nobody's going to know you're wearing a lip liner but yourself. So give it a try. And when you're doing it, I'm often asked, one question I get asked very often is, what about lipsticks? And if I wear a darker lipstick, or I wear red lipstick, or what about the lips when they bleed? Well, that's the main reason you want to wear a lip liner, because what does a lip liner do? It acts as kind of a dam. And your lip color is like the water, the moisture. A lip liner is made dry with a drying ingredient, and it kind of builds up around the lips. So it really will hold your lipstick in place to where it needs to be. In fact, if you want to keep your lipsticks on all day, what we do for the award shows, we fill the entire lip in with the lip liner. We put the lipstick on, then we blot the lipstick. We put powder over the lips, reapply the lipstick, and then a little bit of gloss. And I guarantee that's on for 3, 4, 5 hours. Will not move. But don't forget your lip liner. Here's an example of a girl I did with a campaign I was working on. And it's funny, she came in and she really had the thinnest lips you could imagine. So what did I do? I get a lip liner, I build it up, we put a beautiful red lipstick, but look how beautiful those lips are. But if you look closely, they're about half that size, but nobody would ever know. So anyway, when you are doing your lip liner, ladies, make sure you don't do it too dark. And you don't want it so light it doesn't make a difference. You just want a good color that matches your lipstick that's a little bit darker than. And once you put your lip liner on, get a brush. Most lip liners will have a brush on the end. Get that brush and just smudge it on the entire lip so it doesn't become just a small line on the outside. You're really building the entire lip. I know you're going to love that. All right, and lipsticks. What lipstick do I wear? William, what lipstick do I wear? I'm this age, I'm that age. My hair is this color. My skin is this color. Help me find the perfect lipstick. Ladies, I'm going to leave that to you because it does not matter. As long as it goes with your skin tone, age doesn't matter with color. Barbara Streisand is a perfect example of someone that wore her same lipstick when she was in her 20s. She's always worn a very soft beige color. Then into her 70s, she's still wearing that beautiful soft beige. She likes the look. She knows it works for her. Diana Ross is somebody else that wears a coral. She's always leaned towards a red or a coral, never anything too blue or pink. She knows it works for her, but again, it's worked for her when she was in her 20s. It's working for her now in the 70s. So again, it does not matter. Carmen, are you all fans of Carmen? If you're not, I hope you are. She's in her 90s. She is still working as one of the top models in the world. And she's always loved a pink, a reddish pink. She says, pink makes me feel alive. It makes me feel happy. So I'm going to wear it. So again, ladies, whatever color lipstick you want to wear, whatever feels good to you, wear it. But let me tell you a fashion look for 2022, which is huge. And I'm so thrilled about it. It is red. We are doing so much red lipstick. I always tell my clients, have a red lipstick in your wardrobe. You never know when you want to wear one. But I love red. We're seeing it on the red carpet. We're seeing it casual dress. Look at these beautiful reds. The secret of wearing a red, especially as we get a little older, is to keep it a vibrant, true, beautiful, bright red. What you do not want to do is wear those dark brown burgundy reds that are, you know, they used to call them vamp. I call them vampire lipstick. I love this too. When you want to go shopping, of course, here in the States, but especially in Europe, the ladies throw on, you know, a pair of slacks, a white shirt, get a big bag to go shopping with, put a pair of sunglasses on, and all you need is a red lipstick, and you look like $1 million, right? So have the red, have a perfect red. I created a red in my line, which I call the perfect red, and it's not too pink, it's not too orange, it's got cool, it's got warm, and I'm thrilled with it. I think you will be too, and here is Helen Mirren just wearing this rocking red lipstick, again, at any age. A friend of mine did a movie called A Me Price. I digress for a moment, but let me just tell you a quick story if I can. And the actress that did it was a 30-year-old actress, a beautiful actress named Anastasia. And the movie was she became a 30-year-old woman. And by the end of the movie, she turned into a 90-year-old woman. She sells her soul to a devil or something. I forget the movie. But I remember at the premiere, I'm sitting next to the makeup artist, and Anastasia looked like a 90-year-old woman. And I said, what did you do? How did you turn this beautiful 30-year-old into a 90-year-old? He said, basically what I did is I used a dark burgundy brown lipstick on her. And I really thought of that, and I looked at it. Those colors just seem to draw the face down and bring attention to every fine line. So again, ladies, if you're using those dark, dark, dark colors, my opinion, throw them away, get something bright and beautiful on the face. All right, gloss. Speaking of bright and beautiful, here I am doing an event with Barbara Sinatra. I used to do her makeup and I adored her. And she used to say, William, I don't care what you do with my makeup, just make sure I've got gloss. Because she knows that gloss is such an important part of your makeup wardrobe. It brings shine to the face. And what happens? It shines on the lips right back up into the eyes. I find it to be very important. And you can wear gloss alone. You can wear it with lipstick. When you're applying your gloss, just put it on the bottom. You don't need it over the entire lip. Just put it in about the third of the bottom lip, and it moves around and gets where it needs to be. But again, it really is important on that bottom, because that's where it catches the light and goes right up into the eyes. Here's a few of my muses. Broadway star Carter Calvert wearing gloss over just a beautiful red lipstick. So yes, you can wear gloss over lipstick. You can wear it alone. You can wear it over lip liner, or you can wear it over lipstick. My next client, Denise Williams, wearing a beautiful gloss, but you can see how that just emphasizes that beautiful shim and sheen to the entire face. And then Jackie Joseph, a dear friend and client, who at 83 years old, we did her makeup. What was the one thing I made sure I did? I put gloss on, because it brings brightness and shine to the face. When I created my gloss, it's called Billy's Brilliance, I wanted to get the perfect shade. In cosmetics, when I was working for some of the major cosmetic lines, they used to say, now make sure and sell all of your clients 4 glosses, a cool, a warm, an evening, and a day. So when I created my own line, I said, this is ridiculous. I want to find one perfect shade that every woman can wear, and you can wear it day, night, whatever it is. So guess what I did? I go to Cindy Crawford, who people have always said had the most beautiful color lips. And they are perfect without anything on. She's got these amazing color lips. And I said, Cindy, I need to just basically use the color of your lips for my gloss. So I got that color. I turned it into my gloss, and it's called Billy's Brilliance. And what I'm going to be doing for you all today, well, until the end of the month, I'll tell you later, is I want to send you all one of my Billy's Brilliance as a complimentary with your Billy's Blues orders. So I'll tell you about it later, but I do want you to all try that. I want you to wear it. It's got vitamin E, it's moisturizing, it's lovely. Let me tell you a quick story about, speaking of my gloss, I was at the Grammy Awards, and my team is all gone. They've all left, and I'm just making sure everything is set, closing up my makeup kit. I'm ready to walk out the door. And I have to preface this story by saying, when it comes to music, I go to the Grammys and the American Music Awards. I don't know a lot of the entertainers. I mean, I'm looking for Doris Day and Rosemary Clooney, though. That's what I listen to. So I don't know a lot of the people, but I'm getting ready to leave, and this beautiful blonde runs in. She says, can you help me? Look at this lipstick. And I said, well, it's horrible. Why did they put that on you? She said, I don't know. What am I going to do? So I said, sit down. And the people are at the door calling her. They're saying, come on, you're on. So I just got off this horrible lipstick she was wearing, and I got my gloss, put on my Billy's Brilliance, nothing else, just threw on my Billy's Brilliance, got her out the door. No idea who it was. And then the next day, I'm looking at the red carpet, and I'm looking at the pictures of the celebrities at the Grammys. And apparently, her name is Pink. And many of you may know her. So here she is wearing just nothing but my gloss. So I find that to be kind of funny. It makes me realize I've got to start getting a little bit more involved in the music industry. All right, ladies, thank you so much for your patience. I hope you're learning and getting some tips. Red carpet trend number 5 is... yes, red carpet trend 5 is exact matching foundation. I think this goes without saying. I don't think this is a trend. I think this is just such an important part of makeup. Whether you're wearing a liquid or whether you're wearing a mineral foundation, it doesn't matter. We want it to match your skin beautifully. And when I say match your skin, I'm talking about a couple different elements. One, we don't want it to be too dark. Have you ever been with somebody who's wearing their makeup too dark? I have an illustration here. I will show you. Dark foundation, it doesn't match the neckline. It just doesn't work. I bet you've all seen this. I'm always sitting by this person next to me when I'm on an airplane. And I just want to say, wonder if she'd mind if I told her that her foundation's too dark, but I would never do that. Or you don't want to go too light. Look what happens when it's too light. Even celebrities with, you know, high paid makeup artists sometimes get it too light. And this has to do with, I think, when you're doing your makeup, you're in a certain area, you might have too much light, not enough light in your bathroom. You step outside and it can be completely different. This happened to Kelly Osbourne. I'm sure this looked beautiful in her studio, but look how yellow it is. And that's probably the most important thing, ladies, that you need to remember when you're finding a foundation. Are you cool tone? Are you warm tone? All of us are either cool, all of us are warm. And you can tell by, do you have pink in your skin? Do you have redness and pinkness in your skin? Is your skin more yellow, more golden? So whichever color you are, that has to be your foundation. Some women have come up and said, yeah, but if I'm pink and I do a warm foundation, it will kind of balance it out or cover it. But that's not true at all. You want to make sure that whatever your undertone is. And then to find the perfect foundation, I love to just stripe the face. Clinique used to do this back in the, back in the, I guess, 70s. They would actually stripe the face. So you can see what we do by striping the face. Find the color that's perfect for you. It will match the neck beautifully. Let me tell you one more quick story. I was doing a show called, what was it called? Oh, it was the silliest show. It was called Roller Games. And we had all these two teams, you know, roller skaters against each other. But the fun part of this show is that we would have guest speakers in between and guest performers. So Blondie, Debbie Harry, was one of our guests, and she came backstage, or we were getting her makeup done. I wasn't doing her, but my assistant was doing it. He came over and said, Debbie needs a really light foundation. So I gave him a light foundation. I gave it to him. He did it. He came back later. He said, no, Debbie needs a really light foundation. So I gave like just a really white color. I said, this is the lightest I have. It was like white. Put it on. She went away. She was thrilled. And I asked the makeup artist later, I said, well, wasn't that foundation too light? Why did Debbie want such a light foundation? He said, because she knows her skin so well that her skin turns the foundation a couple shades darker. So here she was with that white foundation, but look how gorgeous it matched her neck. So anyway, ladies, get to know your skin, know what color your foundation needs to be. And some of them do go a little darker, a little lighter. Put it on, let it sit for about 6 to 8 minutes, and then you'll get an idea of truly what it looks like before you purchase. Also, ladies, use a foundation brush. If you're not using a brush to put on your foundation, you'll see such a difference. It's like painting a wall, using your hands, a sponge, and your fingers. I think you'll love putting your foundation on with the brush. Small downward strokes. All right, I have to share with you my number one secret. Oh, I just very quickly, I wanted to show you what I consider to be an easy, the perfect look. Lip liner, lipstick, a touch of gloss, a bit of blush, two easy colors on the eye, filling the brows in with a pencil, a liner, navy mascara, you're out the door in 5 minutes. All right, ladies, my number one makeup secret for looking youthful and refreshed is, do y'all know what it is? All right, it's glow, it's effervescence, it's radiance, it's shimmer. The older we get, we lose this into our skin. So I say throw away all your matte products, all those products that are dull or dry or bring that dryness to your face. Everything you use should be bright. It should have effervescence. It should bring light to the face. Here's a couple of people wearing a product, and there's many products that do this. It's usually an effervescence cream, a lotion. Mine is called Billy's Blues Glow. You just do a pump, you mix it with your foundation, you put it on the skin, and look at that beautiful, healthy glow. That's what we want to do. We want to be glowing, we want to be healthy. And you can see that it's everywhere you look nowadays, but it is such a beautiful, youthful look. So do remember, ladies, when you're doing your when you're putting on your makeup, those drying products, those matte products, let's get rid of those. Bring some products that are bright. And with the glow, there's a couple ways you can do it. You can put it on, just mix it with the foundation and put it all through the entire face. You can actually just put it in your moisturizer if you're not using foundation. Or what I do is I put it in with the moisturizer, I do it with the foundation when I'm getting a client ready to go out. And then I just do a little extra just on the cheek area, a little bit on the forehead, a touch on the nose, just areas where that natural light would hit the face. But oh, it makes such a difference. It really does. Even Raquel Welch, look at the beauty in her 80s wearing it. All right, ladies, it's my job. I need to teach you how to take the perfect photo. I know at your wonderful Red Hat gatherings that you often get together. And I've seen so many great pictures of you all on the site. But I want to share with you how to have the perfect photo every time. All right. So here it is. Let me show you what I don't like first. These are some people on the red carpet. None of my clients, but I want your opinion. Oh, this is me at the last Emmys working with the client, because it really is. There's a specific way to stand to make sure that you look beautiful every time. All right. So here's a look I don't care for. And you let me know what you think. I don't love this when the feet are crossed, the arms on it. And I mean, it's just too much going on. When I see something like this, I always say, "Wow." Next, look how, and a lot of the younger celebrities are posing like this. I don't get it. I'm not going to say it, but what does it make you think? When I see this, I want to say, okay, it's on the second door to the right. You're excused. I just don't like this look with the legs being crossed. Next, it's very awkward if you just stand straight looking at the camera, one arm down, one arm on your hip. It's just a very awkward pose, in my opinion. Next, your weight always needs to be back. If it's too far forward, look what happens. It looks like you're apologizing to the camera. And we never want to do that. We're all too fabulous. We all want to be amazing in these photos. So never do that. I also do not like it when arms go in front of the body. I mean, if you see that photo, what are we looking at? We're looking at her beautiful hair, her beautiful makeup, her gown. We're all just staring at her hand holding that bag in her crotch or in her thigh saying, why does she have that there? But you see it all the time. I'm always amazed. Same thing with the hands in front of the body. I think you just look embarrassed. And the number one mistake that we all make, crab claws, all right? I bet if we all go looking through our photos, we'll see pictures of us with our hands and our hips. And it's so hard to make your hands look beautiful in a photo. And hands go to about twice the size in a photo that they are in real life. So those hands, those crab claws, as I call them, really kind of destroy pictures. Ladies, here's how you're going to want to stand. Look at this gorgeous pose. What you do, your weight is far back. You have one foot forward. Your feet are in a T. You're bending the front knee. Your hips are completely away from the camera. Your shoulders are down. Both hands hanging down at your side. Evening back to the side. And look at that beautiful pose. I want you all to practice this. Here's another picture. Holly always looks beautiful. Again, the hips are away from the camera. Look at that knee. And there's always that bent knee and the arms are just down to the side. It's so sophisticated, so beautiful. You know, you don't get better than this look, Sharon Stone. Again, you don't need to have the hands around the body. You just be confident, be beautiful, keep the hands down. And look at Renee in the last Academy Awards. See how far back the weight is. So remember, your weight is far back in a picture. You don't want to lean forward. You actually want to tighten your core, lean back. And then you want to take a breath, relax the arms, and look right directly over the camera. Don't stare right into it, because then it's like, oh my gosh, Facebook stalker, right? You want to keep it just slightly over the actual lens itself. And then it's beautiful. If you insist on putting a hand on your hip, make sure that the palm is against the hip. Don't have crab claws, but if you do want to have a hand on the hip, make sure that it's a hand on the hip and not crab claws. All right. Ladies, there's so much I want to tell you today. I'm having such a good time. I hope you are as well. I do want to tell you one more story. So I'm sitting at home and I get a call from Faye Dunaway. Well, not Faye Dunaway. It's her people calling my people. And my people are me, right? So I'm just sitting there answering the phone. Would you come do Faye's makeup for the Academy Awards? I said, well, of course I will. It was an honor. Went down, got her, I think, looking quite beautiful. She was lovely. And I'm leaving. She says, William, you know, give me some tips on the red carpet. I'm thinking, my gosh, what can I teach Faye Dunaway on the red carpet? She's been doing this forever, right? So I said, well, Faye, you know what? Just remember, no crab claws. Make sure that you're wearing a long dress, a beautiful evening gown, that you pull it up all the time, you know, like move it around so you never step on it and it's always looking beautiful. And also, Faye, make sure that with your evening bag, you hold it down to the side, always pointing downward, which I think is a wonderful way, you know, to with your evening bag, never hold it up, never clutch it, always just hold it down pretty facing or pointing the floor. And I said, I think you're going to be fine, Faye, have a great time. So didn't think anything of it. The next morning, front page of LA Times, guess what I saw? Okay, Faye, can you believe this? So everything I said not to do, she did. You can see what happens when you don't hold your evening bag beautifully. You've got to make sure your hands look lovely. You don't want it in front of your body. You don't want to step on your dress, and you don't want to have crab claws. So anyway, I guess I failed. What can I do? What can I say? All right, ladies, what I would like to do just briefly before we get to your questions and we choose our winner and I tell you just a little bit about the cosmetics, I want to make sure that you all know the colors to be wearing this season. Not that you have to go out and buy every new color, but you know, I think it's a great time to open up your wardrobe and say, have I worn this? Have I worn this in the last 5 years? Does this still fit me? Oh, that's what I had to do after this, these last couple of years. Those COVID 10 turned into, you know, COVID 15 for me. So a lot of my clothes, even though I know I'll get back into shape, they're going to be outdated by the time I can wear them again. So I just go through my closet. I think, you know, what organization would like some of these clothing? Let me just clean it out. In my mind, I always want to say, close your eyes, pick something, and you know that you can wear and put it on instead of pulling out so many things and saying, no, I don't think I want to wear this. No, this doesn't quite look right. Oh, this was missing a button. No, this one. Try to go through your wardrobe. As you do your makeup, makeup is the same thing. Every so often, go through, get rid of the makeup, bring in fresh. But anyway, for those of you that do want to really wear something new and wear a fun new color, of course, each year we come out with the colors of the year, the color of the season, and you don't need to wear entirely that color, but it's fun to add a little of that to your wardrobe to really stay current. So what are the two hottest colors right now? Island green. I mean, we did a lot of yellow this fall, a lot of gray this fall, a ton of blue. That Mediterranean blue is so popular. Continue to do that through winter, and Mediterranean blue especially. Continue on. Your men, make sure they're wearing their blue suits. I mean, it's so popular. But really, coming into winter and especially spring, summer, you're going to be seeing this beautiful green called an island green. It's kind of light, it's kind of dark, it's kind of bright. Here's some more pictures of it. It's just kind of a fun green. So really, you're going to be seeing a lot of this, not only in clothing, but you're going to be seeing it in paints and accessories and, you know, eyeshadows, all kinds of things. So just have fun with it. It's a beautiful color. So if you like to wear green, wear green. But now let me tell you the color, really the big color of the year. It's been around fall, it's winter, it's going to be huge to summer and spring. And it happens to be my very favorite color. I'm thrilled. Periwinkle. And I would think you, especially ladies of the Red Hat Society and Pink Hat Society, is perfect because periwinkle is a purple, it's a blue, it's a lavender, it's a violet. It really has varying shades, but it really is a periwinkle color. You're seeing it all over the red carpet, or all over, yes, the red carpet, but also you're seeing it on in all the fashion houses, you're seeing it on the runway. It's a blue meets lavender is how I describe it. They're calling it peri blue. It is so pretty. You're finding it in shoes. You're finding it in handbags. I mean, any of these blue lavender colors are so beautiful and so popular. And don't forget your men. Lots of men are wearing periwinkle shirts, periwinkle or kerchiefs, suits. I mean, they really, and guys look great in that, especially with the gray hair. Oh my gosh. It's very flattering, very complimentary. Helen Mirren, who I've spoken of before, who I just adore, I find her to be such a fashion icon, is already wearing this beautiful periwinkle at awards and around town. And I think it's just wonderful. So when I had to share this with you, Kacey Musgraves was on the red carpet wearing a deep periwinkle, but she matched it with red. And I applauded. I said, yay. It was kind of a tip of her hat to the Red Hat Society. Whether it was or not, it is such a gorgeous combination. I just think it's wonderful that you all have chosen this to be kind of your mantra and your color choice. Anyway, I think it's just beautiful. All right, ladies, what I'd like to do for just a moment, then I'm going to announce the winner, or I'll take a few of your questions, of course, and then I'll announce the winner of our contest. But I did want to just tell you briefly about my cosmetics, because it is, I'm very proud of it. After being in the industry for 25 years, working with top cosmetic lines, I said, I want to create a cosmetics company that's made in the United States, that is cruelty-free, does no testing on animals, uses natural ingredients, is not incredibly expensive, but that I have complete control over, that I pick the colors, I create the colors, and I put my name on it, so that I'm very proud of it. So I created Billy's Blues about 8 years ago, and For those of you that go to my Billy's Blues website, I hope you do, and I hope you sign up for a newsletter, because I offer promotions all year, and I do a monthly newsletter giving tips and fashion advice, and it's a wonderful way for me to stay in touch with you all, because I feel like we're family, I really do, and I do answer every email. So anyway, another thing that I do on my site is I choose a muse, and this is a woman that I find to be inspirational, that I find to be beautiful. And just last month, I had the pleasure of shooting Kathy Garver. Many of you may remember her from Sissy, from Family Affair. But she is an author. She's a speaker. She's done so much. She continues to act. And I know she won't mind me saying that she's in her late 70s. But look how beautiful she is. Most of my clients, I do find her over the age of 50. And my muses go anywhere from the age of 50 up to 90. But I love that, because I love it, because I think a lot of us over the age of 50 feel a bit forgotten. I know I do, and I know a lot of my clients do. And so I like to show them and prove to them how beautiful we can all be with just a couple simple makeup techniques and tips. So ladies, let me show you, if I may, just a couple of my products. This is that instant glow that I was telling about, just a pump mixed in with your foundation, a tad on the body. You can even put it on your shoulders or your legs, anywhere where you want that shine. You mix it in, or just take it when you're done with your makeup, take a little bit with your fingertips or a brush and just pat it on areas where you want instant glow. I find it beautiful. I love that. I do make a foundation brush. I don't like brushes that have animal hairs involved. Mine are nylon. They're easy to clean. And you just brush on your foundation downward strokes with that nylon brush. Next, ladies, I do have a lip liner. It's a color called Elegant Rose. I make one color, works with all lipsticks. Go ahead, put it on. On the end is a brush. You're going to just brush that lip liner softly into the lips so we have no harsh lines. Next, my red lipstick. I'm so proud of it. I've actually named it the Perfect Red. It's pink red, it's coral red, it's gold, it's silver. I find it to work with every skin type. And for those of you that want to get kind of crazy and do something fun, try a new red, have a red in your wardrobe. It is called the Perfect Red. My lip gloss, ladies, again, I've told you about it, it's called Brilliance. And with every Billy's Blues order, I'm going to go ahead and give you all my Brilliance lip gloss. Go ahead, put it in the bottom of the lip. Wear it on your lips morning and night. It's got moisturizers E in it. I think you'll love the way it makes your lips feel. Next, I just want to show you my blush I created. I'm very proud of one blush color that works again with all skin types. It's warm, it's cool, it's got a little bit of a peach in it, it's got a little bit of a rose in it, and softly apply it all around the entire face area. Don't forget the neck, don't forget along the jawline, and just make it look like that natural glow. Eyeshadows, I did not go, oh, I'm sorry, my brow pencil. Yes, I have one color called Taupe. When I put on a brow pencil, small little strokes through the entire eye area, I find Taupe works for every hair. Unless your hair is very red or very, very black, what I recommend doing is filling your brows in with the Taupe and then getting your eyeshadow brush and just with a little bit of a black eyeshadow or dark brown eyeshadow filling in, or a red or a bronze shadow if you're a redhead filling in. But your basic eyebrow, I use Taupe on all hair color and I think it works beautifully. Next, just two eyeshadows, champagne and chocolate. You don't need to go crazy. A light color all the way up to the eyebrow, all the way down to the lash line. You get that second color chocolate. You just smudge it a little bit in the outside. Should take you no more than just 20 seconds. It's easy, it's natural, and I think you'll love the look. Next, we have my Wonder Lash. Wonder Lash, they were created in the 1960s. The most popular lash in the world. They went away. I found the son of the Wonder Lash family. And he said, do you know what? I have some Wonder Lash preserved from when my mother and father started the company, and they are fabulous. So we got together. He's allowing me to sell the Wonder Lash, the original Wonder Lashes, a little glue. You put a little glue on, it comes with the Wonder Lash. I send out the glue, put them on. I have them in black. I even have them in blue and green. So it's kind of fun. Have fun with them if you haven't tried them. Try some lashes. Don't throw them away, though. Remember, these last forever. So these are not disposable lashes, but I think if you've not worn them, you'll have a good time wearing lashes. And then my mascara, it's called The Mascara. It's a navy blue no fiber in it. If you're looking for a mascara that has a lot of the fiber, which basically fall down onto the bottom of your face, this isn't the mascara for you. Mine is a cream mascara, a European formula, meaning that you put it on, it's got emollients, it makes the lashes look thicker, fuller, but it's not crazy with those little spidery pieces. And it's in navy blue. And ladies, when you're putting your mask on, remember, go underneath the upside of the lash, but also go on top of the lash as well. Your lashes will look twice as big. All right, thank you so much. So again, billysblues.com, and the code is redhatrh20. And I'll give you 20% off your entire order now through the end of the month. And I will make sure and send all of you that beautiful brilliance. Daniel, are you there? Do I have time for a few questions, or can we?
You definitely do.
The winner, right?
We have so much to do. We've got about 10 minutes left in the show. We've got tons of questions in the chat here. The first one from Chris Pierucci. Sorry if I mispronounce your names too. Do you use a white eyeliner on the bottom of the eyes?
I love that. Yes, I do. And Chris, thank you for knowing that. I mean, that's a real almost secret. Absolutely. If you want to make your eyes look larger, they have these wonderful pencils out you can buy, and you go ahead and it line the inside of the waterline. Look at every Judy Garland movie. She wore it and you can see it. So the inside of the waterline, you do white, a little bit of a smudge of a darker shadow underneath, and the eyes are twice as big. So absolutely. In fact, I'm probably going to be bringing one of those into my line, but thank you for reminding me. It's a wonderful product.
And then I think when we were talking about eyebrows, she also asked, how can I match my hair? She's a redhead. How can I match my hair color?
Well, and what you want to do, that's what I like to do, is I like to just do a basic taupe eyebrow. A taupe is beautiful because it's got blonde, it's got brown, it has a little red. It's just a good base color. But if you have a beautiful auburn or beautiful red, rather than get an actual eyebrow pencil, you're never going to get that close match. So what I do is I just get a shadow. I do a taupe base, and then I get an eyeshadow which matches your hair color. You can certainly find some of the bronzer, the redder bronze tones, the brown red tones. And then with your eyeshadow brush, just put a little bit of that in to match the color. But start with the taupe, then just add a little bit of that color. Same with gray. A taupe is great with gray hair. But then if you want to get a silver gray eyeshadow, take a little bit and just smudge it over it, and you should get that pretty exact match.
I love it. So we, on speaking, Diane Davis on the red-haired train says, our hair is now graying. Is there a after washing stay in color rinse that we can use to brighten the red?
Wow, that is a good question. And I hope, ladies, you'll invite me back. We probably need to do a whole show on hair and wardrobe and all kinds of fun things, but you know, and that is something to ask your hairstylist. If you're asking, is there a color that you wash in to get rid of the gray to match the red? I don't know if that's the question. They do have rinse out hair dyes that you can do that, and they will get rid of the gray and they match. It's just kind of difficult sometimes, you know, because trying to get that red, if you have white here and red here, by the time you put the red on, it doesn't always match. It's one of those things, if you have a good hairstylist you can go to that will do that, maybe that's the best alternative now. But all you can do is try it. They do have those products too, which I've never used, so I don't know if they're great or not, but they're colors, and they have them in red and taupe and black, and they're like a powder that you just can't put on with the brush. And apparently they work great in between touch-ups. So maybe even something like that might work. So give it a try, but let me know. I want pictures of all of you. I want everybody to send me pictures of your new look and your new makeup. Go ahead.
And he definitely does check those and uses them. Yes, definitely. He does actually want you to send pictures, and he does actually look at all of them and keep in touch with everyone. So also, so after having chemo, having thin air, do you know of any kind of products for, like, you know, they've tried biotin and other thickening shampoos, but do you know anything on the hair front that might do well with thickening hair, maybe after chemo treatments at all?
You know, I don't, but I will certainly find out. I mean, I will definitely ask. I have so many friends in the industry that, you know, I can certainly try to find out for you. I really don't, you know, unfortunately, that's one of those things. I know they have different products you can take and pills you can take, supposed to help with thickening your hair, and products to put on. You know, I love a wig. I know they're not comfortable and not everybody loves it, but you know, I have so many clients that have had thinning hair, and so many of my clients have gone through chemo and things that I think if you can get just a comfortable, maybe wig to put on or a great hat, something that just gives you that confidence until maybe it does thicken up. And if it doesn't, again, I think wigs are great, great answers. But you know what I will do, Daniel, I will do this and I will, if you keep that name or if there's an email, mm-hmm. I promise to check with some friends of mine and doctor friends and plastic surgeons and everything else. And I do promise I'll see if there's something out there. I'll get you that name.
Definitely, for sure. And then also, one thing about makeup, how long should one keep makeup? How old is too old when it should be thrown out?
Oh, you know, I went to a client's home, oh, I don't know, before COVID, but she had me clean out her makeup. She said, come look at my makeup. And we opened up four drawers bigger than me. And there were things from the 80s and the 90s and things from years ago. And I said, even though a product looks good and you might be able to get it, you know, put it on, get rid of it. 2 years is benchmark. Any product you have, a powder, anything after 2 years, it starts to dry, it can get bacteria. So any of your actual dry products, your pencils, I use 2 years as a benchmark. Wet products, mascaras, liquid products, any of that, 3 months. And that's FDA, that's not me trying to sell mascara, that's actually FDA. This says because you open a mascara and you put it in, you open it, you're shoving air all the time into this liquid product. And I apparently after 3 months, bacteria does form or can form. So couple years dry products, your liquid products like mascara, 3 months, 3 to 4 months and get rid of them.
I love it. So and then talking about foundation, Marcy's asking, so do you use a primer under your foundation? Why or why not? And then also there was another question about where do you stop applying foundation?
Well, generally primers are wonderful if you have really oily skin and you want to keep your makeup on a little longer, you can get a matte primer that will hold it in place. Sometimes if you do have a lot of blotchiness to your skin, a primer can actually help with that. I don't use a primer a lot with my clients just because generally a foundation now is, you know, does enough coverage. And I usually use a concealer. If there's some spots or some blotching, I'll do a concealer. Then I put a foundation on. But if you do have problems with your skin absorbing foundation, so you need to use one, go ahead and use them. I think they're fine. You just want to make sure that it doesn't have a lot of sun protection in it, because a primer with sun protection in it can clog the pores. So just make sure you get a good primer. And as far as foundation, I go right to the neckline. Unless you've got discoloration or something on the neck, that's why you want to find your foundation right here and look at it next to the neck. So this is the color of your foundation. Whatever this color is, that should be the color of your foundation. So right along the neckline, stop your foundation.
There you go. And then Barbara's asking, is there a trick to extend the eyeliner to outside of the eye? Mine never seems to look right.
Oh my gosh, Barbara, did you say?
Yes.
Okay, Barbara, you need to be here with me. You know what it is? I think it's just one of these practice trial and errors. I mean, I don't know that there's a secret to it other than, you know, you start here on the corner with your pencil, you go all the way to the outside edge, and then you never want to come to the corner of the eye and then up, because that closes the eye. So what you want to do is you want to get your liner, go all the way to almost the edge, and then go right up to meet the end of the eyebrow. But you want to do it before you get all the way down. You never want the liner to touch the bottom lash, because then it's going to close. You always want to have a little space right out here. In fact, sometimes I'll take a little white and put a little bit of white out here, and I bring the liner almost to the end and then bring it up and then just smudge it upward a little bit. All you can do is practice and try it. And I hope it works. I hope it does. One day what we need to do, Barbara, we'll talk to Deborah. Maybe what we can do is we'll do an actual live makeover and we'll have somebody doing the makeup and we can all do the makeup at the same time. And we'll get together and practice and play that way. I hope so. Fingers crossed.
I love it. All right. So we've got a couple that we are just about at our hour time frame. There's still so many. Everyone is loving all of this information that's popping through in the chat. Now, William, somebody asked, where do they send these pictures to? What email address is the best email address
you
to
know,
send to?
You can, at my Billy's Blues site, there's an email. I think it's info@Billy's Blues. Or do you know what? Facebook is great. I hope you'll all friend me on Facebook, and my Billy's Blues Facebook page is a great place to send me these photos, because sometimes if they're fun, I'll put them up, or and anything you send me from billysblues.com comes to me. And I even think my personal email, which is my name of William Edward Squire, at msn.com is on my site as well. So you can get in touch with me, and please do. I'm here, and I really do answer questions, and I love to look at them. So,
yes, indeed, he does. It's all right. So I put everybody that has asked a question in to the raffle. So it is time to actually go through here and figure out who our winner is going to. I know. I can't. And once again, it's for a full makeover, virtual makeover from William.
I'm also going to send you all of my products. So you'll have those before. So you will sit down in front of your camera with a clean face, and we will create and make your makeup. We'll make a whole new fun look for you.
All right. And you know what? It was our first person that asked the very first question. It was Chris Pierucci is going to be our winner for the actual raffle here today. So Chris, she's had tons of questions actually throughout the course of today. So you're going to be able to even ask more of those to William. So congratulations on that. Once again, go to billysblues.com to enter in the newsletter. It's on the very main page, scroll all the way to the bottom. Just enter your name and email address, and you can keep up to date with William and all of his things. So I'm going to get out of here, and William, I think, is going to close out the show with a couple more things here. So thank you so much, everybody, for joining us here today.
Thank you. Thank you, Daniel. Good to see you. See you again soon. Chris, congratulations. I will be emailing you, and I will get your mailing address. I'll send off my box of Billy's Blues Cosmetics, and then we'll arrange a time when we get together and can create your new 2022 fabulous look. All right, ladies, we've been talking today a lot about beauty, about outside, about hair and makeup and everything else, but we all know where beauty comes from, correct? True beauty comes from inside, from feeling beautiful. We all know those women that you look at and everyone else thinks they're beautiful, but they're not beautiful because their soul isn't beautiful. They're not beautiful on the inside, and vice versa. I know we all have friends that may not be considered perfectly beautiful, but they radiate when they come into a room because of that inner goodness, that inner beauty. I have a quote I want to share with you. The two most beautiful accessories a woman should own is a heartfelt smile and true self-confidence. Who said that? Well, I guess I did, actually. So anyway, I always tell my clients, I don't care how gorgeous you look or what you do, wear a smile, feel good, feel beautiful, and you light up the room. All right, every morning I get up, I say, shoot for the moon. Even if you miss, you land among the stars. Ladies, life is short. As I know, you're all together because you want to have fun and make the most out of life. But every day, get up, thank yourself for waking up. Thank the above, thank God, whoever it is that you want to thank and say, I've got another day of living. Let's make it a great day. Try new things. All that can happen is you fail. You'll try something new, but continue trying new things. Continue learning. Red Hat Society, thank you so much for inviting me. I can't tell you how much I think of you and your group. It means the world that you would spend time with me. And as I say, I hope that we continue our relationship. I hope I get to meet a lot of you in person, and I hope I get to see you again virtually again soon. So until then, from me to you, be happy, be healthy, and be beautiful. Have a great day. Thank you so much.
Traffic will allow. Nowhere could you get that happy feeling.